I feel like growing up as a surfer, we're in the water, we're seeing what's happening, we're seeing what's washing up on the beach, we're seeing what's in the ocean, the turtles, everything. We're like on the front line of the problem. So it's a very easy mesh to be like, what can I do? Like, we already live this crazy life. And sometimes I almost feel guilty how amazing it is. You know, I get paid to do what I love, super fortunate. I wanna do better.
My name is Wes Carter, and I'm the president and third generation leader of Atlantic Packaging, a company founded by my grandfather in 1946. I'm also a husband and the father of 8-year-old twins and a lifelong surfer, traveler, and outdoorsman. And I've seen firsthand the devastation caused by plastic pollution in our oceans, lakes, and rivers. Today, Atlantic is the largest privately held packaging company in North America, and we support companies in almost every manufacturing vertical, which gives us the unique ability to use our influence to help the supply chain transition away from problematic packaging that threatens our global waters. A New Earth Project is a coalition of outdoor enthusiasts, industry-leading brands, and innovative packaging suppliers all working together to solve these problems. Because it's about all of us, it has to be. Please join us on our journey to a new Earth.
Most years, I try to take at least one surf trip. You know, the older I've gotten, the further I like to go. You know, I'm an explorer by nature. I'm a curious person by nature. So I want to see the world, and surfing has been a great way to do that. The most significant surf trip we took on my 40th birthday, which coincided with my younger brother Scott's 30th birthday. He also works at Atlantic. We hatched up a plan to do a boat trip to the Mentawa Islands in Indonesia. And the surfing in the Mentawas is well above our skill level, but we felt like it was sort of a once in a lifetime deal, and I'm 40 years old. I'm like, I better do this if I'm going to do it. And so we actually compiled about 18 guys and went over there and had just an amazing time. I love that trip because every single day you'd surf at least 5 or 6 of the greatest waves of your life. Every single day. It was amazing. And go to bed every night at 8 o'clock as tired as a person can be. One of the heartbreaking things about that trip too was these islands are pretty, you know, pretty undisturbed. There are some indigenous cultures of people living there that we got to meet that was really wonderful. But the other thing we saw was a lot of plastic pollution. When you're on a white sand beach, you know, in the South Pacific, and literally one of the most beautiful places on the planet and arguably some of the best surfing on the planet, and there's plastic pollution floating in the water and up on the beaches, it was really heartbreaking, and it was kind of staggering.
It's about everyday consumers, everyday Americans, everyday, you know, global citizens saying, we demand sustainable products, we demand sustainable packaging, we demand recycling infrastructure to deal with these products. We will not sit by and watch the oceans turn into landfills. We have a culture of young surfers, up-and-coming surfers that are elite athletes. People that spend a lot of time in nature, you just naturally begin to recognize that rhythm and that truth. And so taking care of the earth, nature, natural resources becomes incredibly obvious if you are engaged in the outdoors on a regular basis. If you talk to any of the guys that have been in the professional surfing world for any significant amount of time, they will tell you.
The amount of plastic in the water, I remember surfing with Shane Powell and Shane Herring one day, thinking, if I fall and I take a gulp of water in my mouth, I might get a bag and die. I might get choked. Because there was that many plastic bags in the water. I couldn't believe it. It was like seaweed everywhere.
I don't need to talk to an oceanographer. I don't need to talk to a scientist. I can talk to a surfer who has been traveling the globe for the last 20 or 30 years just like me and witness this firsthand.
Of course, we just keep fighting and trying, but man, it's so devastating seeing how much environmental damage we've done.
grew up, when I was like 3 years old, my parents left Tabor City, you know, where the newspaper was started. And initially we moved to Wrightsville Beach. You know, really is the backdrop for my youth. And so, like most kids who grow up at the beach, I started off on a bodyboard, which we called boogie boards back then. But really, and this may be surprising to some people, my like love for surfing didn't really start until I was in my 20s. You know, I grew up surfing a little bit, I surfed as a kid, but then by the time I was like a teenager, I moved in a different direction. But when I got out of college, I moved back to Wrightsville Beach, you know, and you know, when I was in my early 20s living at Wrightsville Beach, I had a lot of my buddies that I'd grown up with who were all kind of moving back after college, and started surfing every single day after work. You know, we'd all had different kinds of jobs. At that point, I was working at Atlantic in the warehouse driving a forklift. And so, you know, at 5 o'clock when I clocked out, like, you know, after sweating in the warehouse all day long, like getting in the ocean seemed like a pretty good deal.
There may be customers and companies that drift away from Atlantic or challenge what we're doing, but in my heart and soul, I really believe in what we're doing. Our leadership believes in it, and I believe our employees overwhelmingly believe that they're a part of something really special, and we're gonna continue to build on that momentum. We don't live in a static world. We live in a dynamic world. Things are always changing.
Collaborating with a company like A New Earth Project, who has all these resources and like the platform to be able to do whatever we want, it's like, it's perfect, because it's something I want to do. It's not like a paid post or just like, yeah, just give me a check, whatever, I don't really care, it's not aligned. This is so aligned that I'm like, let's go.
The first meeting with Koa really struck me, honestly. Like, I was blown away for a guy his age to be so passionate about environmental issues, about the oceans, about the Hawaiian Islands. The guy just glows wellness.
Come to a beautiful beach like this, it's just like the typical Hawaiian white sand beach. You look closely and you're like, wait, that's not even sand, that's plastic.
You start to realize that, like, you are nature. You're not something separate from it.
I travel everywhere. This is my baby right here. I never use a water bottle. But when I travel and I go on a plane, it's like, they give me like 16 plastic cups. And
they're all
like,
this big.
Yeah, I'm just like, no, like fill this up. And they're like, oh, we can't, like pricing. I'm just like, oh my gosh.
The big brands, they'll listen to what you and I say if enough of us are saying it.
I basically just started reading certain people who are really critical of the industries and the things they had to say. And I thought, well, I think that you could make a company that could fix those aspects of it. So the social compliance aspect and the environmental side of textiles. And so you could put the supply chain together right and make a company that was being responsible for people on the planet. And so that's kind of our tagline for people on the planet.
The first time I met Koa was at his business, the Sunrise Shack, where, you know, he's, you know, out there servicing customers all up and down those islands with really healthy meals and breakfast and shakes and bullet coffee and all the great things that they serve there. Usually when I'm on the North Shore, I eat there like every day. These guys are, you know, they're not only interested in being great surfers, but they are interested in creating great products. And they're asking the right questions, like, what type of container should we put this food that we're serving people? Do we have the right recycling infrastructure on the Hawaiian Islands to deal with this? And if we don't, who do we need to talk to? You know, who do we need to advocate with, you know, with these local municipalities to say that, hey, we want a higher level of recycling in our communities. And then it's also like, you know, where can we serve products in reusable containers, for instance? And if we are gonna sell takeaway type containers, are they biodegradable?
Just like a little coconut shack that we just kind of moved in, and then it became something pretty special. And now we opened one up in Waikiki. Then we opened another one up right at Shark's Cove by Foodland. So we have three on Oahu, and then we have five in Japan, one in Oxford, England.
The public does need to understand
that like most of what you put in that recycling bin is not getting recycled.
Yeah.
Even a lot of those plastics that are recyclable, we just don't have the infrastructure currently in the United States to recycle plastic at all, really. Yeah. So even when people think they're putting it into a blue bin and it's getting recycled, most of that stuff is either ending up in a landfill or in the environment. The best thing for recycling in the United States is paper-based products. If we introduce more sustainable packaging solutions as a brand, the consumer's gonna reward us.
It's not fake. I mean, you know, they live it. And I think that's an important part of this. And one of the things I'm trying to do too, I think you have to live sustainability. You know, in order to be an advocate for it, I mean, we have to look at all areas of our lives where, you know, we can be more environmentally conscious.
So then they print it with recyclable ink, because you can recycle your newspaper, right? They printed a logo on it. And you can do this with any logo. You can do it with, you know, if you're shipping coffee somewhere or shipping any item. Like when you get an Amazon package and it's got one little thing in there and it's got little plastic air pillows.
Yeah.
You can actually take this and they've got machines that will crumple it up and it protects that individual product in the big box from it. And you can customize it to your logo.
And, you know, it's not about perfection, but, you know, we all need to be pushing in that direction.
The idea for me was to, number one, take care of people and also create a good supply chain that was, you know, healthier for our environment. The amount of waste in this world from clothing that goes into landfills, I think it fills an Olympic swimming pool every couple of minutes or something that goes into a landfill. The environmental aspects of clothing and design is disastrous. And we aren't told those things. So although I didn't want to be preachy, I wanted to try to be educational and let people know that kind of stuff. There has to be some real stuff behind this.
The voices of professional surfers in particular, because of their exposure to the global pollution problem, is a credible voice.
As surfers, we see, you know, I've said that before, we're like the canaries of the sea and we get to see all the crap that's up on the beach, and it's up to us to bring that to light and to work on those things. So that was really the big part of me starting this company.
Over here at Backcountry Swell are making skateboards out of all this plastic we get today, so we're not just putting it back in the trash, they're actually making something useful that makes you have fun. So panning for gold, microplastic gold, look at that.
This smaller stuff can be shredded down even smaller, surprisingly, and then we put it through a heating process, melt it down, put it into a mold. And then we press it and it turns out like these bad boys.
So we actually make skateboards out of recycled plastic, whether that be microplastic, macroplastic. Doesn't matter the plastic, as long as it's recycled, it's for us.
These machines already exist and we just wanted to create like kind of a budget friendly shooter, because these machines cost like 10, 15 grand. And so we made one in our garage. It was all made out of garbage. There's one piece in it that's not garbage. We love skateboarding. We both grew up in the outdoors and we love everything to do with it. Skateboarding is just the start. Obviously this is a small board, you know, it's only about 24 inches. We're gonna be moving to full-size skateboards, snowboards, and even surfboards in the near future.
Problem not solved, but we have a small solution.
I found a hard hat to put my garbage in. I was out of a bag, so the earth provided.
We just got some candy. Nah, not quite.
I got it. Yeah, more trash coming my way. I feel like when you dig a little deeper, that's where you find all the trash. And I haven't really moved much. Like that, boom, that's trash.
Look at all the bottles, McDonald's. We got it all in here.
Green bottles.
You name it, we got it.
Flipper, buoys, poke bowls, Dawn dish soap.
There's some sandals in there.
This is my catch of the day. Melt it all together, pour some clear resin, maybe some glitter.
It looks like shells, you know, so like white, blue, green, black. It's hard to spot sometimes, but we've narrowed it down piece by piece.
We're incentivizing the trash pickup by doing this raffle. We're giving away a couple skateboards.
So they thought that'd be super cool if we could melt plastic and recycle it into a skateboard and use it as something that like we can all share. So when they first started, there's a lot of trial and error. lot of long nights. I waited a super long time for him to come home.
What else can we make with this? Can you make me fins or a surfboard or maybe like a, I don't know, a coffee cup or something?
Yeah, yeah. So all the plastic we use is like good for, you know, drinking out of. We are like R&Ding like surf fins right now. We don't know enough about surfboards, which obviously you do.
Yeah.
To know how to make one out of recycled plastic. And so it'd be something that we could sit down and talk about. Get your board.
So super epic you found a way to reuse this stuff. They might make me a board, maybe some fins. I don't know. We'll see. See what the future holds for us. Thank you so much, Mark.
It's kind of cool how we can get the community together and do something like this.
It's really interesting about this beach plastic is that a lot of it's been in the ocean for 5 or more years. So we're super glad to be able to help out with the recycling process. And just thanks again so much for everyone for coming out.
57 pounds!
It's overweight! Woo!
You've got many, many major organizations out there that are manufacturing packaging. They're making packaging all day long, every day. Plastic packaging, fiber-based packaging, whatever it may be. Then you've got consumer products companies that are buying packaging, that are utilizing that packaging. And then you've got a company like Atlantic that is in the middle. And we are distributing products, we are consulting with companies, we are optimizing packaging. Our whole value proposition is showing customers, consumer products companies, how to effectively use packaging so they don't have damage primarily, but also how to do it in a cost-effective way. But in the world of sustainability, it gives us the ability to be a really impartial arbiter when it comes to what is sustainable.
On the next episode of Journey to a New Earth.
Hawaiian society was thriving because of this system known as the Ahupua'a system. The Ahupua'a system is essentially an incredibly sustainable system that channels water into these very productive systems of growing taro primarily, but a variety of other different types of foods. The real ingenious part is these auwai, which is basically diverting these streams, would come back into the ocean. And at that juncture where it hits the ocean, there would be these large fish ponds. And we're talking massive fish ponds, like 4 or 5 football fields, some of them very large.